In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, distinguished viewers, welcome to this exclusive interview with the Deputy Secretary General of al-Nujaba Movement, Hajj Nasr al-Shammari. Welcome, Hajj.
Thank you. God bless you.
In this episode, we will cover the anniversary of the Islamic Revolution in Iran. During this anniversary, strategic analysts say this revolution that was victorious in 1979 changed many equations in the world and the region and led to the emergence of Islamic resistance movements in the region. How do you view this situation, and will these resistance movements continue in the future, or will they fade away? مستمرة في المستقبل أم إنها آيلة إلى الزوال؟ بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Greetings to you and to your respected followers and viewers. We must congratulate the Islamic world and all the oppressed people across the globe on the anniversary of this revolution, which provided a voice for the oppressed that can reach every corner of the planet. In response to your question, probably before the blessed Islamic Revolution in Iran, there were resistance and freedom movements in the world, and especially in the region, but they did not possess the power or capabilities or importance. Even the most popular movements, namely the ones in Palestine, resisted with rocks, protests, and with their hands or burning tires, because they did not possess any weapons that could reach the enemy. This was clear by the way the Islamic and Arab world retreated during that era. If we were to analyze, we will see that since the birth of Iran's Islamic Revolution, the enemy has been retreating. Israel's major slogan is from the Nile to the Euphrates. When the regime used the slogan in every confrontation with Arab countries in the region, it would steal and occupy more territory. Ever since the founding of the Islamic Republic, the establishment and the brothers in the Islamic Revolution Guards Corps have been supporting, arming and training resistance movements. As a result, Israel, since its inception until now, has been in retreat. Israel fled from Lebanon. All of South Lebanon was liberated completely from Israeli control. After its forces reached Beirut and raised the Israeli flag on the presidential palace there. In occupied Palestine, Israel has retreated too. Now, parts of Palestine, despite being small in size, have some kind of autonomy. Just recently, we commemorated the anniversary of Israel's 22-day war on Gaza, which is a small city. For 22 days, the Israeli military, including all its forces, its naval forces and air force, encircled and attacked Gaza. But at the end, they were forced to retreat without achieving any goals. The resistance movements are present and have achieved great victories. Perhaps the clearest example is the American occupation forces fleeing Iraq. America came to Iraq bringing its air force as well as more than 300,000 soldiers and established the military bases there. They had hundreds of bases in different locations on Iraqi soil. And they possessed the supreme authority over everything, raiding homes, making arrests, closing roads, violating schools and universities, killings, and every criminal act imaginable. Despite that, the Americans themselves admitted that 80% of their military losses in Iraq came from what they called armed groups backed by Iran, by which they mean the Islamic resistance factions. So the resistance in the region, while imposing a new geographic status, is here to stay. And God willing, a complete axis will be formed. This resistance will transform and achieve its main goal. The goal at the current stage is to wipe out the entire American military presence in the region, to avenge all the terrorist acts U.S. forces have committed, and it will be a base for the arrival of our hidden imam.
Also, as a result of the aftershock of the Islamic Revolution, there are uprisings and popular movements from Yemen to Nigeria after four decades of the Islamic Revolution. Some of these movements have reached a mature state. How do you evaluate this situation?
يعني شوف لو أخذنا مثالا بسيطا هي مثلا المقاومة في اليمن.
Look, we take a simple example. The resistance in Yemen. Today, Yemen, in terms of its economy, is considered a poor country, which is under full siege by its enemies. There is a big coalition led by the Takfiri Wahhabi regime in Saudi Arabia. The coalition includes other Persian Gulf Arab countries, backed by the Americans and Zionists, to impose this blockade and kill the Yemeni people. In fact, they have destroyed everything in Yemen. However, today, and after more than 5 years, it is the Yemeni resistance that's capable of setting the terms and conditions on the enemy, and not vice versa. The Yemeni resistance is the one that changes the map of political confrontations. Today, the Yemeni resistance targets Saudi Arabia's interests deep inside the kingdom and threatens Israeli interests. Today, all are convinced that for those waging war on Yemen, there is no benefit. In the coming days, we will witness the Yemeni resistance emerge victorious and we'll see a return to negotiations, because this issue cannot be resolved the way the Saudis want. The Takfiri Saudi Arabian rulers will witness a major defeat, and there will be a victory for the Yemeni resistance and a change in the region. Today, the resistance is not only in Yemen, it also exists in Iraq and Lebanon and contributes to creating political change and the balance of power. Consequently, no Lebanese power confronting the Zionist entity can change the political map or make military changes without Hezbollah. Hezbollah is the one that draws the map, and it decides when and where a battle will take place. The same in Iraq. The Iraqi resistance, namely the Popular Mobilization Forces, are the ones that made Daesh flee, of course in cooperation with others, but it had the biggest role. The resistance kicked out the first American occupation before Daesh. It's now leading calls for confronting the new American occupation that Washington wants to resume in Iraq. As I noted earlier, the resistance exists inside and outside Yemen, and even in Afghanistan. Therefore, today the balance of power is in the hands of the resistance. This points to maturity, evolvement, and progress. Some resistance factions have political wings that attract the majority of voters in some countries. Today, the resistance possesses maturity, weapons, thinking, doctrine, and strategy. No side can close this movement, and no enemy can change anything as long as the resistance is present.
The leader of the Islamic Revolution, during a speech marking the 40th anniversary of the Islamic Revolution, spoke about and described the second phase of the Islamic Revolution. Do you see the Islamic al-Nujaba movement in Iraq part of this strategy?
Definitely, for several reasons. Firstly, this Sayyid, this commander, Imam Khamenei, brings together a large portion of the Iraqi population and a big and important portion of the Islamic resistance factions in Iraq. He constitutes the religious leadership and the legal reference that is worshipped by Shia Muslims through carrying out its orders and adhering to its directives. In addition, Ayatollah Khamenei has today raised awareness that managed to wage a struggle so large that would make the Islamic Republic and its allies a global axis against the world's arrogant powers. Today, America does not talk about China, which is its biggest economic rival in the world, with the same level of danger that it speaks about the Islamic Republic and its allies, who are the most important political axis in the world. Therefore, today, the Islamic Republic is managing an axis against an axis controlled by the United States. It is very clear that the American axis is heading towards a breakup. Today, we see that the democracy America has always promoted and used as a pretext to invade and intervene in regions across the globe is fake and forged and is under scrutiny even inside the U.S. According to their own officials, around half of the American people are accused of terrorism, reject their democratic results, and were trying to orchestrate a coup. The axis led by the Islamic Republic is on the rise and has constant victories. That's why the American axis, day after day, is a broken, doomed one, primarily because the slogans they have been promoting and selling has become unconvincing. practicing even in their own country. So you are someone who is a practicing Shia, a believer, complying with this wise leadership represented by Imam Khamenei. You should consider that his speech is applicable to you. His speech applies to us too, because as a resistance movement, we get our ideology from the Islamic Revolution. As a person concerned about political affairs, his speech also applies to you, someone important with a high standing like Imam Khamenei.
During the era of the ex-American President Trump, the Islamic Republic was subjected to maximum amount of pressure. So was the Iraqi resistance movements and the axis of resistance in general. They were also subject to assassinations, some of them high-profile figures from the political and military leadership. But this era has come to an end. How do you evaluate the past and whether the maximum pressure of Trump has affected the axis of resistance, and how do you see the future?
There is an important saying by the late Imam Khomeini. It says, whoever is connected to Allah does not retreat. If you are a person with the belief that there is a life after this life, that there is a judgment day, accountability and punishment, and that there is a major cause, you are currently defending the most noble defense, and jihad is that a person sacrifices his life for the sake of Allah and for the sake of that belief. Then there will be no defeat and no harm can threaten you while you wish and ask Allah to grant you martyrdom. We heard a lot from martyrs Hajj Abu Mehdi al-Muhandis and Hajj Qasim Soleimani, that how they had a desire for martyrdom. They prayed for themselves to achieve this goal and even requested all the believers to pray for their martyrdom. And they sometimes cried, longing for this martyrdom. So at the end, the enemy cannot break the will and the courage of those connected with Allah and their goals in the afterlife. But yes, the pressure was intense, the war was intense, and maybe the most intense one was the internal sedition imposed on us. You really get hurt when you see a section of your people being brainwashed by this fake advert of the global arrogance in the United States, which led some of them to become hostile towards those who defended and protected and sacrificed their lives for them. This was a little painful, but at the end, the belief of the resistance was victorious and remained stable. The resistance, the popular mobilization forces, and the Islamic Republic stayed despite all the pressure, and the enemies collapsed one after another. The last of them was the dark, humiliating, and shameful scene for the American president. You can compare the farewell funeral processions for the martyrs with the humiliating farewell that this criminal Trump witnessed. These are the results. This is the evidence showing who was victorious and who was defeated at the end. As for the future, believe me, in Iraq, for example, America failed to impose its will on Iraq despite having 300,000 soldiers and advanced weapons and occupational rule. Today, America is also unable to reimpose its occupation on Iraq or to control the country or threaten the Islamic Republic and neighboring countries in the region with 10 or 20 or 30,000 soldiers. Neither can the American ambassador impose his reality, whose main task is now how to protect his personnel and interests. Today, the reality is imposed by those who believe in Allah, believe in their faith and in their honor and weapons of the resistance. The enemy has been defeated, and the U.S. cannot return with the same power that arrived under former President George Bush, nor can it come with the same craziness and arrogance under Trump. So we are at the stage of removing this hegemony from the region and the victory for the resistance, God willing.
The Nujaba Islamic movement are considered to be one of the resistance factions active in Iraq. They do not shy away from being influenced by the Islamic Revolution and the ideals of the late Imam Khomeini and Imam Khamenei. Why this influence by the thinking of Islamic Republic and Imam Khomeini?
The guardianship of the Islamic jurisprudence is a religious authority. So if you read the religious books of any religious jurist, you will see that any practicing Shia Muslim will not be excused in the hereafter without retaining his religious activities to a religious jurist, considered a fully qualified one like Imam Khamenei. The guardianship of the Islamic jurisprudence also deals with other issues, as he is the representative of the hidden Imam. So he leads the nation and its interests and oversees its defense and security in the face of foreign dangers. This is part of your Sharia duty, that you are connected with this religious authority. We can compare the differences in the position of the Islamic and Shia reality before the guardianship of the Islamic jurisprudence and after we began practicing it. You will see the difference is very clear. Today, we, the Muslims in general, and the followers of the household of the Prophet Muhammad in particular, have become an important factor in global affairs. We have become head-to-head to all American projects and those of the global arrogance. Frankly, this is a badge of honor that brings pride after pride. I recall here a saying by the martyr al-Sadr, who called on others to join the school of the guardianship of Islamic jurisprudence. He said, before this idea, we were like the dead. And today is like we have been reborn. This is really very clear. All of us will return to Allah and will be held accountable on our actions that we believe are in consistence with the verdicts of the qualified jurist. We take this all to Allah, and if we are not embarrassed in front of Him for being a follower of the guardianship of the Islamic jurisprudence, you will not be embarrassed in front of people either. It is pride for us and all who follow this school.
ولجميع من ينتمي إلى هذه المدرسة.
مع انتصار الثورة الإسلامية عام 1979.
With the victory of the Islamic Revolution in 1979, the Ba'athist Saddam regime cracked down on the Islamic movements in Iraq, especially against the Shia and their scholars. He killed many of them, including high-ranked clerics and the martyr al-Sadr. Even the war he imposed on Iran was possibly to target the Islamic movements there and prevent the same scenario of an Islamic Republic in Iraq. Also, the Islamic movements in Iraq, including al-Nujaba, raised the banner of resistance against the U.S. occupation forces. How do you see the future in Iraq with the ongoing confrontation between the resistance factions and the American occupation in Iraq?
Firstly, the tyranny of the Ba'ath regime and the criminal Saddam, nobody can imagine that time unless they lived through it. If you had a religious book in your home, that was enough to get you executed. If you grew a beard, you were executed. If you participated in congressional prayers at mosques, you were detained, put under trial, and could be sentenced to execution. If you got caught making a pilgrimage to Imam Hussein's shrine, you were detained, put on trial with a lengthy prison sentence or execution. These were not rare cases. Hundreds of thousands of Iraqi people were executed under these charges. Not everyone was executed in Iraq for political reasons. Many were executed for practicing their faith in a very simple manner. But as you know, this wasn't a short period. The Ba'ath regime ruled Iraq with an iron fist for 35 years. After it collapsed, everyone thought the Iraqi people would welcome the American occupation with flowers. The former American president said, the Iraqis will welcome us with flowers. But what happened was quite the opposite. A few days later, millions on foot made a pilgrimage to Imam Hussein's shrine. This happened after 35 years of oppression and attempts to distance the Iraqi population from their religion. So the whole process failed to bear any fruit. Secondly, the resistance emerged in Iraq less than a year after the American invasion. We did not greet them with flowers. We greeted them with rifles and shotguns. The Iraqi nation knew fully well that the Saddam regime, which oppressed them for 35 years, was a creation of the United States, and it was a tool of them. This is not a secret. The leader of the Ba'ath Party, when they overthrew the leader of the Republic rule, Abdul Karim Qasim, said, we came to power on an American train. I mean, the Ba'athists did not hide their links to the American embassy. During the war on the Islamic Republic, the American president would call the tyrant Saddam Hussein by his first name. None of them spoke with each other using titles. They were on a first-name basis, and they signed their letters by writing on the bottom of the page, yours sincerely, Saddam Hussein. And the reply, yours sincerely, Ronald Reagan.
The Islamic Republic produced great men who may go on to make history. Among them is Martyr Haj Qasem Soleimani and Martyr Abu Mehdi al-Muhandis. May Allah please them. These two formed schools for the following generations. How did the revolution create these men, and how was this school formed, and how will this school be in the future that these men formed?
Normally, the personality of a leader sends his rays and lights to the people who follow and join him. This is clear from the cause of Imam Hussein when he decided to sacrifice his life. His companions rushed to do so too, because they had been instilled by their leader. As for this great revolution led by Imam Khomeini, may Allah bless him, his light was also felt by many. From this school, some of the most important figures to emerge are martyrs Haj Qasem Soleimani and Haj Abu Mehdi al-Muhandis. They were affected by this school. They were inspired by the words of martyr Muhammad Baqir al-Sadr, who famously said, "To melt in Imam Khomeini's school as the Imam had melted in Islam." They followed this great personality and used many of his thoughts, and later they became a source of light to everyone who followed them and fought alongside them. We are privileged to have been part of this school that was represented by the two martyrs. We are absolutely sure that by the help of Allah and the firmness of this faith, tens or hundreds of people similar to Haj Qasim and Haj Abu Mehdi will emerge.
On the other hand, the revolution has created men like Haj Qasim and Abu Mehdi al-Muhandis, and after 4 decades of the Islamic Revolution, the opposing axis, if we look at some of the countries that claim to stand by the Palestinians, especially Persian Gulf states, these countries like Bahrain, the Emirates, and even Saudi Arabia are embracing the hands of the Israeli entity ties with Israel. How do you view this axis?
الكيان الإسرائيلي كيف تنظرون إلى هذه الجبهة؟
لدينا مثل في اللغة العربية يقول.
We have a saying in Arabic: lies have short wings. In reality, there was never any confrontation or animosity between the Zionist entity and the rulers in Saudi Arabia or the Emirates or any of the nations that have normalized ties with the Zionist entity. The Saudis are one of the biggest allies and friends of the Zionist entity. It was the biggest defender of Israel's presence and its interests in the region. There is no better evidence than the Wahhabi rulers in Saudi Arabia, who have committed tens of slaughters and waged wars in the Arab and Islamic world, but did not fire one bullet at the Zionist entity. As the ex-American president said, the sole guarantee to maintain the Zionist entity is to keep the Wahhabi rulers in Saudi Arabia. All that has happened is that the secret is no longer a secret. What was below the table is now above the table. Honestly, the Arab Muslim populations in these countries reject treachery, any normalization, and the presence of the Zionist entity. At the end, these governments will disappear soon, God willing, and the people of these nations will unite to wipe out this Zionist entity.
In conclusion, Haj Nasr al-Shammari, the Deputy Secretary General of the al-Nujaba Islamic Movement in Iraq, thank you very much.
Thank you. God bless you.
And thank you, dear viewers, and may Allah's peace, mercy, and blessings be upon you.